the final assignment for the class. We talked about the paper last time. Today, I want to talk about what we're doing instead of having a final exam. And okay, you are coming to life, good. So we're required to do something during the exam period. But given that this is a composition class, I don't think an exam is really the best way to go or shows how much you've actually learned or what you can do at the end of the term. So what we're going to do instead is a group presentation. I would have liked to have given you this assignment earlier to give you more time, but I generally have to, because it's a group assignment, I have to wait until the withdrawal period is over to see how that shakes out so they don't assign people to groups who are then not going to be here at the end of the course. So here's what you're going to do. You're going to show up for the final exam on Tuesday, December 6th at 1 o'clock right here. And you and your group will deliver a 20-minute presentation on an assigned literary topic. Right, so here are the groups. Working on allegory will be Caitlin. Raise your hand so your group members know who you are. Matthew and Kevriana. So take note of who is in your group and make sure to talk to those people and exchange contact information at the end of the period. Working on pastoral will be Bryce, Dale, and Gianna. Decadence will be Ayana, Forrest, and Callie. And finally, working on epic will be Devante. Raise your hand so everybody can see you. Great. Grace and Bethany, who's not here. She's the one who sits behind Grace. Okay, so make sure that you get together, you exchange contact information, you start making arrangements to meet. Right. The longer you take on this, the more time you take on this, the better your presentation will probably be. So here's what the presentation is going to require. One, you're going to have to provide a definition of your topic, right? So you're working on allegory, right? Tell me what an allegory is. This definition will be better if you have cobbled it together from a couple of different sources that you've checked out. I want you to give me a brief history of the topic, including a list of some important examples. I want you to give me a relatively detailed analysis of one representative example, right? So you take, say, what you think is the most important or most typical epic ever written, and you give me an analysis of that, right? You're going to turn in for the whole group a bibliography, right? Show me all of the sources that the group consulted. I only need one for the group. And you're also going to give me a write-up from each group member explaining what each of you did and how much each person contributed. more on this in a minute. Now, you are permitted to use video in your presentation if you want to, but you may use no more than 2 minutes of video. I have had, when I first started giving this assignment, I would have groups come up and their 20 minutes would be eaten up with like 8 to 15 minutes of video, right? Don't let, like, if you want to use video, you can use a short video to enhance your presentation. I don't want you using a video to make the presentation for you, okay? Any questions so far?
And you said this is our final paper, so that final was due to 6.
This is in lieu of a final exam. Right, so you still have to do that final research paper,
okay.
Right? But that's a different project. But yeah, this is what we're doing instead of a final exam. Any other questions? Okay, let's talk about this write-up that I want from you. You are going to turn in, on the presentation day, a short paragraph on each of your group members explaining what that group member contributed, including yourself, right? I want to know your perception of what you did as well. You're also going to rate each group member from 1 to 5 across three different dimensions. One being the lowest, five being the highest. First, I want to know about each person's responsiveness. Did this person respond when you tried to contact him or her? Right? Did they return emails? Did they return texts, phone calls, whatever? Did they show up for meetings on time and ready to work? I want to know about each person's collegiality, right? How easy were they to work with? Were they nice? Were they pleasant? Did they disagree with people in respectful fashion? And finally, I do want to know also about each person's intellectual contribution. Did this person actually contribute ideas to the projects, or did they simply sit back and let other people tell them what to do? Right, and try to rate everybody honestly. While the quality of the whole group's presentation will affect your grade, right, so a good presentation means a better grade for everybody, I am grading each of you individually. Right, so if one person doesn't do his or her part, it's not going to drag down the rest of you. So I want you to be honest when you are giving me your assessment of what everyone did. Right? Don't just give everybody fives or everybody but yourself ones. All right, so any questions about that? We're clear? Okay, then just a couple of tips then on giving a good presentation. Now, you know best what keeps you engaged in a classroom, right? What actually holds your interest. How likely is it that somebody droning on in a dark room in front of a PowerPoint presentation with a lot of cramped writing on it is going to hold your interest for very long? No, it's going to put you right to sleep, right? And you want to engage your audience. You want your audience to care about what you're saying, to be interested in what you're saying. So you can use PowerPoint, you can use Prezi, you can write things on note cards, but I would encourage you to try to do things to engage your audiences, right? Think about the classes that you actually enjoy going to, the classes you like the most. Think about what the instructors in those classes do to keep your interest, and try to mimic those techniques as best you can. So you can use PowerPoint, you can use Prezi, but try to use them just as visual aids, right? If you need to show pictures, that's what those are really designed for, that's what they're actually best for. In fact, there's some reliable research that suggests that prolonged exposure to PowerPoint actually makes people stupider. So just keep that in mind. Other things to note here. A good presentation also is going to be a well-integrated presentation. Right, I can tell if you just assigned everybody a part and everybody went off and did their different things and then you just showed up on the exam day and this is the first time you're giving the whole presentation, right? Meet frequently, keep in touch with each other, consult with each other, and work together on different parts of the project, right? This also stops people from resenting each other if you're working together on different things, because some of the tasks that you're being asked to do are a lot easier than others, right? Coming up with a list of representative examples, for one, is a lot easier than doing a detailed analysis of a text. So share these responsibilities. Try to put an equal work burden on everybody. And it's also good if you're able to bounce off of each other a little bit while you're speaking, right? Don't just have one person stand up and talk for 5 minutes and then step to the side while somebody else then gets up and talks for 5 minutes, right? Make it look like you actually put this together as a group. In fact, actually put it together as a group. Finally, I do also expect that you're going to take the research portion of this seriously. So the research guidelines are more or less the same as they are for your final paper, so consult that for information as to what sorts of things you can use, what sorts of things you can't use. I do also want to note there are a couple of really good starting points where you can start working on a definition and perhaps also get information for other more specialized sources. The first is a book by M.H. Abrams, and it's simply called The Glossary of Literary Terms. And this will include an entry for each of these four terms that you can then use as a point of departure. You should also check out the Cambridge Companion series. These are books that feature essays that are pitched at a student audience, that like each book is based around a particular author's work or a particular genre. These are also things you should be considering probably for your paper. Finally, there are two series you should look at. There's the Very Short Introduction series, which is put out by Oxford University Press. And I believe there is one for each of these four genres. So you can get a very short introduction to epic, a very short introduction to allegory, and it's the page. The books are small. They're usually about 80 pages long total, and it gives you a good sort of rundown of the history and primary features of a given topic. They have these for non-literary topics as well, and the new Critical Idiom series, which I think is also put out. It's put out by Routledge. These should also have volumes that are dedicated to each of these four topics. So these are the places where you should start. You should be able to get them, if not from our library specifically. I think our library actually has a lot of these Cambridge Companion books in the e-brary. So you can just sort of go directly and access the e-book from the library website. But yeah, if you can't get these from our library, you can get them from other libraries in the system. And I might actually have a couple of these lying around. So if I do and you can't find one on your own, then just come talk to me and I'll see what I have. Okay, so any questions about the research portion, about any of this at all? Nothing? All right, one last thing I will say, because this is a group project, you are dependent on other people to get this done, right? And I realize, I understand that other people are not always 100% reliable. So if you have somebody in your group who is consistently problematic, who doesn't show up for meetings, doesn't return calls, doesn't seem to be doing anything, right, let me know. I won't use your name, but I will talk to that person. Okay? All right. This is on Georgia View, yes. Yes. All assignments are on Georgia View. That was a lot harder than I wanted it to be. Sorry about that. Speaking of assignments, one more thing to note. Remember that you are required to do two discussion board posts on drama, right? Over the course of the next couple weeks. So two on drama. Okay, so how many of you have some experience with Shakespeare already? How many of you have read Shakespeare before? Okay, almost everyone. Now, did you read Shakespeare, or like a No Fear Shakespeare, or some other such? Shakespeare. Okay, good. Then high schools are doing their job. All right, which play did you read? Is it this one or something else? Macbeth, okay. Pardon?
I might have read part
of it. Okay.
I can't.
Yeah, it's been my experience that usually if somebody has read a Shakespeare play in high school, it's probably this or Macbeth. Those seem to be the two big choices. Okay, so Do you know anything about what drama looked like in Shakespeare's time? All right, then why don't we start there? Now, as we go through this play, there is one thing that this has in common with the Greek play that we looked at. Mostly in terms of what it's missing. Do we have very specific stage instructions or set up here? If they want us to know what a location looks like, what usually happens? Pardon? Yeah, well, usually what will happen in this play, if they want to talk about like what the place physically looks like, right?
Okay, yeah.
Like the character will actually step and describe it, right? Tell you where you are. And this has to do with the limitations of the stage in Shakespeare's time, right? So when he was writing, professional acting companies had sort of just started settling down into permanent theaters. What they'd been doing in the generation before was traveling from town to town and performing in the courtyards of inns. So this is what the Elizabethan theater actually was based on, was the courtyard of an inn. That's what it still looked like. So you had a stage in the center on a raised platform. Behind it, a wall with two doors in it for entrances and exits. Between the doors, you would usually have a tapestry hanging for eavesdropping scenes. You have a level above this with a balcony for scenes like that balcony wooing scene in Romeo and Juliet, if you're familiar with that. And then up above all of this, you would have a little tower, the battlements, where scenes of guards walking back and forth, looking out for trouble, would be played. Now, in the stage itself was a trapdoor, which led down to what the actors referred to as hell. They called it hell because this trapdoor was used for the entrances and exits of actors playing ghosts or demons or evil spirits of various sorts, right? So any kind of supernatural creature usually came up through that trapdoor. So in this play, for example, the scenes with the ghost would enter from the trapdoor, do its little revolve around the stage, and then go back down into hell when it was done. There would be an open courtyard around the theater where the cheapest, quote-unquote, seats would be located. And by seats, I mean ground that you could pay a couple of pennies to stand or sit on. Right? There were no seats there. And so these were the very, very cheapest seats. These were where ordinary people would station themselves. And most of these plays, if you actually play them out in full, they're several hours long. So you came for like a full day's, full afternoon's entertainment. So you usually brought a meal. And these two upper tiers were more expensive seats for wealthier patrons. Right? The most expensive seats were the ones up at the top. The sort of mid-range seats for your upper middle class sort of bourgeois patrons were in the center here. So what does this tell us then about who went to the theater?
Everybody.
Yeah, everybody went. Which makes the job of the playwright difficult because it means he has to appeal to different levels of sophistication and interest in his audience, right? He has to try to write a play that pleases these groundlings down in the cheapest seats, because most of them have brought food with them. And if you don't please them, they're going to start throwing that food at the actors. And you have to start, you have to please the people in the more expensive seats, because if you don't, they won't come back. So most Greek tragedies are relatively pure in that they focus only on that single tragic action. Plays in Shakespeare's time are much more kind of hybrid sorts of productions, right? So Hamlet, broadly speaking, is a tragedy. Of a particular type that we'll talk about in a minute. But for a tragedy, it also includes a lot of clowning, a lot of dirty jokes, in addition to the sort of high tragic revenge plot. Also, a lot of violence. If there's one thing that Elizabethan audiences loved, it was bloodshed. That was something that appealed to people in the cheap seats and the expensive seats. Everybody wanted to see a good little bit of the old ultra-violence. So the reason why we tend not to see very specific set descriptions, why the characters will spell that out, is because it's relatively hard to get set pieces on and off a stage like this. So it's purely a practical matter. So characters will simply wax poetic about where they are and sort of tell you, this is what this looks like. Ah, this is the great forest of Arden, or, you know, so on and so forth. Now, characters also tended to dress like contemporary Elizabethans. They didn't dress in whatever period they were supposed to represent, right? So the characters in Hamlet are supposed to be from Denmark, right? By and large, even though half of them have Italian names. But they don't dress like Vikings, right? They dress like people walking down the street in Shakespeare's own time would have. Now, what about women's roles? What do we know about women's roles? They're played by men, usually by apprentice boys in the company, whose voices hadn't changed yet. And this is why there are usually relatively few female parts in a Shakespeare play. The playwright always had to write for the company he had. So each part in this play was written with a specific actor in mind. So you wrote for the company you had. And most companies only had a couple of apprentice boys at a time. So they were the ones who would end up playing the female parts. Now, if you want to get a sense of what Elizabethan drama looked like in practice, there's a relatively good reconstruction of it from a BBC production from the 70s of the sort of the play within a play scene, right? Not all plays were performed in these outdoor amphitheaters. Some of them were performed at court. So there's a good example of one of these court performances. You may recognize Sir Patrick Stewart as Claudius the King in this scene, because apparently you can't make a film of Hamlet without including Patrick Stewart in some role or another, as we will see. And the projector can wake up anytime. And of course, no sound.
You cannot be capon so. I have nothing with this answer, Hamlet. These words are not mine.
No, not mine now.
My lord, you played once in the university, you say.
Did I, my lord, and was accounted a good actor?
What did you enact?
I did enact Julius Caesar. I was killed in the Capitol. Brutus killed me.
'Twas a brute part of him to kill so capital a part there.
Be the players ready.
Have a lot of stay upon your face.
Come hither, my dear Hamlet. Sit by me.
So, good mother, here's metal, more attractive.
You my friend.
Lady, shall I lie in your lap?
No, my lord.
I mean my hand upon your lap.
Aye, my lord.
Did you think I meant country matters?
I think nothing, my lord.
That's a fair thought, to lie between maids' legs.
What is my lord?
Nothing.
You are merry, my lord.
Who are I?
Aye, my lord.
Thank God, your only chief maker.
What should a man do but be merry? Oh, look you how cheerfully my mother looks. And my father died within these 2 hours.
Nay, just twice 2 months, my lord.
So long? Nay, then, let the devil wear black, but I'll have a suit of sables. Oh, heavens! Died 2 months and not forgotten yet. Then there's hope a great man's memory may outlive his life half a year.
Play itself. What would usually happen before the play began was the clowns that worked in the company would perform a pantomime called a dumb show that would show you the plot of the play in miniature. That's what's going on here.
The sun and moon make us again, Count Aure, love be done. But woe is me. You are so sick of late, so far from cheer and from your former state, that I distrust you. Yet, though I distrust, discomfort you, my lord, if nothing must.
Faith, I must leave thee, love, and shortly too. My operant powers their functions leave to do. Thou shalt live in this fair world behind, honored, beloved, and haply one as kind, for husband shalt thou
have. Oh, confound the rest! Such love must needs be treason in my breast. In second husband let me be accursed. None wed the second but who killed the first.
One would.
The instances that second marriage move are base respects of thrift, but none of love. The second time I kill my husband dead when second husband kisses me in bed.
I do believe you think what now you speak, but what we do determine of we break. Purpose is but the slave to memory, a violent birth but poor validity. So think thou wilt no second husband wed, die thy thoughts when thy first love is dead.
Nor earth to me give food, nor heaven light. Sport and repose lock from me day and night. To desperation turn my trust and hope. An anchor's cheer and prison be my scope. Each opposite that blanks the face of joy, meet what I would have well and it destroy. Both here and hence pursue me lasting strife. If once a widow, ever I be wife.
If she should break it now,
'tis deeply sworn. Sweet, leave me here a while. My spirits do go. In vain I would beguile the tedious day with sleep.
Sleep, rock thy brain, and never come mischance between us twain.
Madam, how like you this play?
So let's just sort of step. I think you get the idea. Now, the reason I let it run for that beginning part as well, where Hamlet is making all of those little double entendres to Ophelia about, you know, fair thoughts lying between maids' legs, that sort of thing, is to give you an example of the sorts of crude humor that were often employed in trying to keep the least sophisticated part of the audience happy. Now, what Shakespeare does that a lot of other dramatists of his time didn't do as well is he actually manages to integrate that into the plot. What are all of those little sex jokes making that Hamlet's making at Ophelia supposed to indicate to others who might overhear them? Well, let's think about it this way. What does Polonius, Ophelia's father, think is the cause of Hamlet's madness? Yeah, he thinks that Hamlet has gone mad for love of Ophelia, and being denied access to her has driven him crazy. So Hamlet is making those little jokes for the benefit of people who think this is why he's nuts. Right? So the crude humor is integrated into the plot structure of the play rather than being in sort of separate little interludes. Now, as far as the play they're watching, right, the plot very, very closely mirrors that of the plot of Hamlet. And Hamlet is a play of a very popular type for its era. It's called revenge tragedy, or tragedy of blood. And most of these plays follow a very specific formula, right? You have some wronged party who becomes an avenger. Like either, you know, someone has killed his father or his bride-to-be or some such thing, or one of his children, and the avenger then goes on a rampage, and usually through trickery and deception, kills all of those who have wronged him. So these plays are bloody, violent, for the time. They are sexually explicit, mostly in language. Highly sensationalistic. So Hamlet fits this general pattern in a lot of ways, but it's actually doing some things that are much more sophisticated and much more complex than what the average tragedy of blood was about. So it might help if we try to just sort of take this apart scene by scene and figure out what the bigger issues are at stake. Because I know that the language can sometimes be an obstacle with Shakespeare, so I know that we kind of need to go slowly and first establish just exactly where we are. All right, so let's start with scene one here, and I'd like if I could have a couple of volunteers. I need a Bernardo, a Francisco, a Marcellus, and a Horatio. So, who feels like walking the parapet on guard duty? Can I get a Bernardo? Anybody? Grace, be Bernardo. Great. Can I get a Francisco to relieve Bernardo on guard duty? All right, Forrest, be Francisco. A Marcellus to stand guard with Francisco. All right, Caitlin, great. And then I need a Horatio to be skeptical about the ghost. Anybody? All right, Ayana, great, be Horatio. So all right, we start, page 1082, act one, scene one. A guard station atop the castle. Enter Bernardo and Francisco, two sentinels.
Nay, answer me. Stand and unfold yourself. Bernardo? You come most carefully upon your hour.
It is now struck 12. Get this door, Francisco.
For this relief, much thanks. 'Tis bitter cold, and I am sick at heart.
Have you had quiet guard?
Not the mouse stirring.
Well, good night. If you do not meet Horatio and Marcellus, the rivals of my watch, bid them make haste.
I think I hear them. Stand ho, who is there?
Friends to this ground. I'll live us the day.
Have you good night?
A farewell, honest soldier, who have relieved you.
Bernardo hath my place. Give you good night.
Exit Francisco.
O loving letter. What is Horatio there?
A piece of him.
Welcome, Horatio. Welcome, good Marcellus.
What has this thing appeared again tonight?
I have seen nothing.
Horatio says 'tis but our fantasy. And will not be, and will not let the lady take a hold of him, touching this braided side twice seen of us. Therefore, I have entreated him along with us to watch the minutes of this night. That as again this apparition come, he may approve our eyes and speak to it. Touch, touch, 'twill not appear.
Okay, stop. Pause there for a minute. Now, what is this meant to establish about Horatio? Yeah, Horatio is a skeptic. All right, good, keep going. Starting with sit down a while.
Sit down a while and let us once again assail your ears, that are so fortified against our story, what we have tonight seen.
Well, sit we down and let us hear Bernardo speak of this.
Last night of all, when yon same star that's westward from the pole had made his course to illumine that part of heaven, where now it burns, Marcellus and myself, the veil and be one.
Enter ghost.
Peace break to you, look where it comes again.
In the same day your wife became that's dead.
Thou art our scholar, speak to Horatio. Speak to Horatio.
Looks are not like a king, mark it.
most light. It heralds me with fear and wonder.
It would be so to speak to it, Horatio.
What art thou thus usurped?
Usurped.
Okay. Usurped this time of night, together with that fair and warlike form in which the majesty of Barry Dinmark did sometimes march. By heaven, I charge thee, speak.
It is offended. See, it stops away.
Stay, speak, speak. I charge thee, speak.
Exit ghost.
'Tis gone and will not answer.
How now, Horatio, you tremble and look pale. Is not this something more than a fancy? A fantasy? What think you?
Before my God, I might not disbelieve without the sensible and truth of that.
All right, thank you. Stop there. Very good. Very well done. Everybody, give him a hand. All right, so what is this scene meant to establish right off the bat? Why does the play begin with this scene? What are we supposed to get from this?
The ghost,
yeah, the ghost is going to be important, right? But what else does this establish about the ghost? They know him. Yeah, they recognize him. And if Horatio in particular, who doesn't believe in ghosts, sees the ghost and acknowledges that he's seen the ghost, what does this tell us about the ghost? That it's real, yes. So the point here is to establish right off the bat that the ghost is real. That Hamlet's not seeing things, that other people see this ghost, and in fact, a skeptical philosopher has seen the ghost as well. Now, it's also important to keep referring to the king as the dead king, right? As the Dane in Denmark. Does anybody know why they do this? Why they call the king Denmark instead of good King Hamlet who has died? Okay, this actually has to do with a sort of Renaissance political theory called the idea was called the two bodies of the king. So the king of any given nation was regarded as being, on the one hand, ordinary private citizen, Hamlet the Dane. But was also simultaneously the embodiment of the whole nation. So the fate of the nation, the state of the nation, is often represented in the body, the physical body of the king. Now, how do we know Denmark met his end? How did he die? We're not told in this scene. We're told later.
He was murdered.
Yeah, he was murdered by his brother. And how did his brother murder him? What did he do? What means did Claudius use to kill Hamlet Sr.? Yeah, he poured poison in his ear, right? So, Hamlet Sr. died by poisoning. And if the body of the king represents the body of the nation, right, poison kills by corrupting the normal functions of the body, by stopping up the normal functions of the body. And so, if the embodiment of the nation has been poisoned, right, the body itself, the body of the nation is now corrupt. Right? This is what, you know, later on Marcellus says, something is rotten in the state of Denmark. Right? The thing that's rotten is the corruption that Claudius introduced. Now, there's another really important thing that looks fairly minor, that's established in this scene, but we really ought to pay some attention to it. Right, so we know that the play is largely concerned with the relationship between the late Hamlet Sr., right, our ghost, and his son, a morose university student recently come home from Germany, and for the moment, not permitted to go back. Now, we have Horatio and Marcellus here rehearse a little bit of recent history. Right. Is it not like the king, as thou art to thyself? Such was the very armor he had on when he the ambitious Norway combated. So frowned he once when, in an angry parley, he smoked the sledded Pollux on the ice. 'Tis strange. This is referring to a recent war with Norway. Thus twice before, and jump at this dead hour, with martial stock he hath gone by our watch. In what particular thought to work I know not, but in the gross and scope of mine opinion, this bodes some strange eruption to our state. Good now, sit down and tell me he that knows, why this same strict and most observant watch so nightly toils the subject of the land, and why such daily cast of cannon and foreign mart for implements of war, why such impressive shipwrights, whose sore task does not divide the Sunday from the week, what might be toward that this sweaty haste doth make the night joint labor with the day? Who is it that can inform me? So what is Marcellus, what's the question he's asking here? What is he asking about? What's going on in Denmark that he wants a reason for? Cast of brazen cannon, impressment of shipwrights. What are they doing? What is the country doing? Or what does it seem to be preparing for? Yeah.
They seem to be preparing for war or some sort of great expedition.
Yeah, exactly. What he's talking about is a massive military buildup, right? We've got all these guys working 24/7, making cannons, building ships. We've increased the shifts of people, of guards on watch, right? Why are we doing this? What's going on? What are we worried about? So there's a massive military buildup going on. Horatio responds, that can I. At least the whisper goes so. Our last king, whose image even but now appeared to us, was, as you know, by Fortinbras of Norway, thereto pricked on by a most emulate pride, dared to the combat, in which our valiant Hamlet, for so this side of our known world esteemed him, did slay this Fortinbras, who by a sealed compact, well ratified by law and heraldry, did forfeit with his life all those his lands which he stood seized of, to the conqueror, against the which a moiety competent was gauged by our king, which had returned to the inheritance of Fortinbras had he been vanquisher, as by the same covenant and carriage of the article designed, his fell to Hamlet. Now, that's a lot of legal verbiage. Essentially what that means, right, they had a war. King Fortinbras of Norway was defeated and killed by King Hamlet of Denmark, and Fortinbras' territory thus became subject to Denmark. Now, sir, young Fortinbras, of unimproved metal hot and full, hath in the skirts of Norway here and there sharked up a list of lawless resolutes for food and diet to some enterprise that hath a stomach in it, which is no other, as it doth well appear unto our state, but to recover of us by strong hand and terms compulsory those foresaid lands so by his father lost. So Fortinbras, the dead king of Norway, also has a son who is named for him, right? We have a Fortinbras Sr. and a Fortinbras Jr. And what is Fortinbras Jr. up to? Yeah, or at the very least, avenging his father's defeat and humiliation at the hands of Denmark, right? Fixing to get his own back, right? To retrieve his inheritance from these vile Danes who stole it. So we have two parallel father-son avenger pairs. It's just that this play happens to focus on the story of Hamlet Jr. and not Fortinbras Jr. But he'll be back. Now there is another father-son pair that's particularly important here. Right, Polonius, the king's chancellor, and his son Laertes. Right, and the important thing that happens in the next scene, right, what does Hamlet want to do now that his father's dead and buried? Before he's encountered the ghost, before anything else. What would he like to do? Does he intend to stay here in Denmark? Remember, you know, Hamlet is a college student, right? Now, if you were told, now this might depend on your particular attitude to your studies, but if your parents told you when you came home on a break, no, you're not going back, you have to stay here with us now, would you be happy about it?
No.
Probably not, right? And that's essentially what Hamlet is being told. Right? No, you're not going back to University of Wittenberg. We need you here, so you stay here. Meanwhile, Polonius' son Laertes has asked leave to go back to France, and what has the king said to that? Sure, we won't hold you up. Go on back to France. Continue your studies in France. Have a great time. So Laertes is granted a freedom that Hamlet is denied. Not only that, we also find that Laertes and Polonius are counseling Ophelia, Hamlet's girlfriend, to stay away from him and to return any love gifts that he's given to her, right? Because as a prince, he's out of her reach and they think he's probably just toying with her. So Hamlet is being barred from the throne by his uncle, right? Because you would think in the line of succession, who should get to be king next? Hamlet, right? But his uncle's sitting there instead. He is barred from going back to university, and he's being kept away from his girlfriend as well. So he's being hemmed in on all sides. He's getting nothing that he wants. And then enter the ghost. And the speech that the ghost gives to Hamlet is particularly telling, particularly important as well. If we look on page 1102, can I get a Hamlet and a ghost? Any volunteers? All right, you be Hamlet, you be ghost.
Word must bow is in the best it is, but this must bow strange by nature, unnaturally.
Pains me to know it that I, with wings aslip, as meditation or the thoughts of love, may sweep to my revenge.
I find thee apt and dual shouldest bow, be then the fat weed that rots itself in the east of the wrath. Holdest thou not steering this? Now Hamlet here, 'tis given out that sleeping in my orchard, a serpent stung me, so the whole air of Denmark is by forged process of my death, frankly abused, but now, though noble youth, the serpent that did sting thy father's life, now wears his crown.
Oh, my perfect soul, my uncle.
Incestuous, that adulterate beast with witchcraft in his wrist, in his wits, with
treacherous gifts, a wicked wit, and gifts that have the power to do seduce one to his shameful lust, the will of most seeming victorious queen of Hamlet with a what a feeling falling off was there from mm-hmm. whose love was of that dignity that it went hand in hand and with the vow I made to her in marriage and to decline upon a rich whose natural gifts were poor to those of mine.
Just to pause there, one thing we notice is that neither Hamlet nor his father think very much of the uncle, right?
No.
They're always comparing him negatively with yes. Hamlet Sr. Okay, continue.
But virtue has it never will be moved, though lewdness court mm-hmm. it is in the shape of heaven. So lust through a radiant angel linked with will say itself in a solicited bed and pray on garbage, but soft Memphis I sent the morning air. Brief let me be, sleeping within my orchard, my cousin's always removed afternoon. Upon my secure hour that uncle stole with juice of cursed hebdomen.
Close enough.
And a vow. Oh my mm-hmm. lord. And then the purchase of my gift. Wepris Diltus meant, whose effect holds such an enmity with blood of men mm-hmm. that with, gosh, that's with us quicksilver, its course is through the natural gates and alleys of the body, and with a sudden vigor of it. Doth prostate incurred like eager droppings into milk. The thin and wholesome blood, so did it mine, and a most instant tenter barked about, most laser-like, with mm-hmm. foul and loathsome crust, and all my smooth body.
All right, thank you. That'll do. Thank you, Caitlin.
Okay.
Valiant effort. Okay, yeah, it's a lot of words, yeah. So, what we see here, right, the King describes the physical corruption of his body by the poison, right? So remember this whole thing about the two bodies of the king. Right? This poison that entered in through his ear now courses through the blood of the whole kingdom, right? As it created a Lazar, like a leper, a leprous crust around his body, so it has done so now to the kingdom, right? So Hamlet's task is not just to avenge his father, right? It's to avenge the king and to clear out a cancer in the nation, to clear out a cancer in the whole country, right? What is Claudius doing at the time, for example, that Hamlet is speaking with his father's ghost? What does his uncle do essentially every night? That's one of the things he's doing, yes. He is sleeping with his late brother's wife. And he's also, when he talks about the king's rows, right? He's throwing these wild parties every night. Right? He's wasting the kingdom's money on lavish pleasures for himself and his friends. Right, when Hamlet mentions, this is a custom better observed in the breach than the observance, right? So, this is something my uncle does that needs to be stopped. Now, one more thing, again, to note in this scene. Once he has Horatio and, who's the other little guy that's here with him? Is it Marcellus? Swear not to tell anything about what they've seen. Look on page 1106. Right, and therefore, as a stranger, give it welcome. There are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than are dreamt of in your philosophy. But come. Here as before, never, so help your mercy, how strange or odd somere I bear myself, as I perchance hereafter shall think meet to put an antic disposition on, that you, at such time, seeing me, never shall, with arms encumbered thus, or this head shake, or by pronouncing of some doubtful phrase as, well, we know, or we could, and if we could, or if we list to speak, or there be, and if they might, or such ambiguous giving out, to note that you know aught of me. This do swear, so grace and mercy at your most need help you. What is he asking Horatio to promise? What is he informing Horatio of? And what's the promise he's trying to extract from him?
Not to tell him.
Yeah, okay, yeah. He's already sworn not to tell anybody about the ghost, right? What is Horatio now swearing not to tell anyone about? What is Hamlet going to be doing? What does he need to do in order to allay suspicion, to misdirect people so that they don't know he's trying to avenge his father? Yeah, and he's trying to confuse them, as it as perchance hereafter shall think meet to put an antic disposition on. What's he going to do? What are we going to see him doing in the next several scenes? Pardon?
Getting mad, pretending to be.
Pretending to be nuts, yeah. He's not really insane. He's pretending to be crazy so that his uncle, Polonius, the others won't catch on to what it is he's really trying to do, so that they won't know that he knows what's up. And so this explains his behavior with Polonius and Ophelia, right? Polonius thinks that Hamlet has gone mad for love of Ophelia. So he encourages that belief when he meets up with Polonius. But his attitude towards the old man is always mocking, right? And the old man doesn't get it. Let's look at scene 2, act 2, page 1115. Hamlet and Polonius have their little tete-a-tete here. Can I get a Hamlet and a Polonius? All right, Hamlet and Polonius.
Yep.
All right, so start with Polonius. Oh, give me leave. How does my good Lord Hamlet?
Oh, okay.
Round line 168. Go ahead.
Oh, give me leave. How does my good Lord Hamlet? How does my good Lord Hamlet?
Well, God have mercy.
Do you know me, my lord?
Excellent, well, you are a fishmonger.
Not I, my lord.
Then I would you were so an honest man, honest a man.
Honest, my lord?
Aye, sir. To be honest as this world goes, it is to be one man picked out of 10,000.
That's very true, my lord.
For if the sun bred maggots and a dead dog, being a god kissing carrion, have you a daughter?
I have, my lord.
Whether not log of son conception is a blessing, but as your daughter may conceive, friend, look taught.
How do you say about that? I'm sorry. Yep. Still hopping on my daughter, yet he knew me not at first. A said I was a fishmonger. A is far gone. And truly in my mouth I suffer much in swimming for my love, for love. Bearing in this, I speak to him again. What do you read, my lord?
Okay, we can stop there, actually. Thank you very much, both of you. Now, important thing to get here is what Hamlet calls Polonius. What does he refer to him as?
Fishmonger.
A fishmonger. What's a fishmonger? Pardon? Yeah, it's a guy who sells fish, right? It's also Elizabethan slang for a pimp. Now, why would he call Polonius a pimp?
Because he's trying to sell his daughter. He's trying to get his daughter off to the king, the actual king. Instead of just somebody who don't have no gold or anything.
Well, he is always, he's always shoving Ophelia now in Hamlet's path to try to get Hamlet to reveal himself, right? Is this why he's mad? And so this is why he says, you know, let not your daughter walk in the sun, right? Conception is a blessing, but like, stop throwing her at me. Stop throwing her in my path, right? You are behaving like a whoremaster. You are behaving like a pimp. And does Polonius get the joke? Completely lost on it, right? He did not know me. He said I was a fishmonger. It's like, yeah, he said he was a fish. He said you were a fishmonger because he knows you. So most of this scene is Hamlet proving his intellectual superiority over Polonius. But also demonstrating to Polonius that, yeah, the reason you think I'm crazy is not the reason I'm crazy. This is not what's really going on. And he does the same little thing for Polonius's benefit in the scene with Ophelia, right? The question he asks her, right, page 1129, when he's telling her to get thee to a nunnery, right, which means either get thee to an actual abbey, an actual nunnery, or get thee to a whorehouse. Right, what's the question he asks her at the end of that speech around line 125?
Where's your father?
Where's your father? Now, why does he ask her that question? Yeah, and who's listening behind the tapestry? Yeah. Polonius is there, Hamlet knows he's there, and this is his indication that he knows Polonius is there and Polonius is listening, right? Where's your father? At home. Right, she's lying to him. So this whole performance is for Polonius's benefit. Poor unfortunate Ophelia is largely collateral damage. Right, this is a typical feature of revenge tragedy, right? The avenger, by and large, cuts all human ties and sweeps the stage clean of just about everyone, even people who are more or less innocent of harming him. And that's the unfortunate position that Ophelia here finds herself in. So we are running short on time, so I don't want to belabor this, but I do want you to pay attention as well to Hamlet's two little buddies who've suddenly shown up out of the blue. Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. Now, why have they come? Have they come out of the goodness of their hearts? No. My lord, we were sent for. Right, they're there not to help him, but to do the king's bidding. And just one thing, two quick things I'd like to point to with Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. In his conversation with them when they first show up, what do they keep trying to tell him his problem is? If we look on page 1117, after he tells them Denmark is a prison, what do they keep telling him his problem is? Why then, 'tis none to you, for there is nothing either good or bad, but thinking makes it so. To me it is a prison. Why then, your ambition makes it one. 'Tis too narrow for your mind. Oh God, I could be bound in a nutshell and count myself a king of infinite space, were it not that I have bad dreams. Which dreams indeed are ambition, for the very substance of the ambitious is merely the shadow of a dream. A dream itself is but a shadow. Truly, and I hold ambition of so airy and light a quality that it is but a shadow's shadow. Why do they keep harping on ambition? Remember, whose bidding are they doing? They're there doing the king's bidding, right? And the king sees, okay, I've stepped in the line of succession here between my brother and his son. So what he wants is to sound Hamlet out to find out if it's thwarted ambition that's making him act crazy, and if Hamlet is thus a danger to him. So that's what they're trying to figure out. And he lets them know that he's aware of what's going on when he tells them at the end of their little tete-a-tete there, you know, I am mad, I am only mad north-northwest. When the wind is southerly, I know a hawk from a handsaw. Right. I know what's going on. You don't fool me. So he's always giving other characters, like, even though he made Horatio promise not to tell anyone that he's not really mad, he keeps giving other characters little hints that he isn't. He keeps giving other characters little hints that he is aware of their motivations, at the very least. That he knows their little secret sins. That he knows what their agendas are concerning him. So, as you finish the play for next time, keep all of this in mind, right? How everyone's little hidden agendas work out for them, ultimately. Where, you know, where there's collateral damage. And what's the fate of these three parallel father-son subplots. All right, so...